Hello listeners, welcome to NIOS. Today we are going to talk about molecular inheritance and gene expression. Now what is meant by molecular inheritance? In molecular inheritance, we'll study the molecules which are responsible for the inheritance of characters from parents to the offspring. And in gene expression, we mean that genes, how these genes are being expressed in the form of proteins. So first we'll take up molecular inheritance. Before we take up this topic, we must know about the cell structure. As we know, there are prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. Prokaryotic cells, they do not contain a proper nucleus or the membranous structures, while the eukaryotic cells, they contain a proper nucleus which is covered by a nuclear membrane. Then we should also know about the structure of the chromosome. Chromosome is made up of two chromatids which are joined through a centromere. Then in the earlier chapters, we have studied about the Mendel's laws of inheritance. Mendel's proposed three laws, the law of dominance, law of segregation, and law of independent assortment. We have also studied the chromosomal theory of inheritance provided by Sutton and Bowery. Now, what is meant by one gene, one enzyme hypothesis? Archibald Garrett, a British physician, he wrote a book on inborn errors of metabolism in human beings. He was working on a disease, alkaptonuria or phenylketonuria. Now, what these inborn errors are? Inborn errors are when the person suffers from the disease right from the birth, that he has carried it from his parents. In case of this alkaptonuria, it's a recessive disorder. What happens in alkaptonuria, the person when passes out the urine turns black on exposure to air. The urine turns black due to the presence of a substance, homogentisic acid, in the urine. While in the normal individuals, homogentisic acid is converted to acetoacetic acid by an activity of an enzyme. But this particular enzyme which converts homogentisic acid to acetoacetic acid is absent in individuals suffering from alkaptonuria. Archibald Garrett, he was the first to connect a human disorder with Mendel's laws of inheritance. He deduced that alkaptonuria is a recessive disorder. Then Beadle and Tetum actually proposed the hypothesis, that is one gene, one enzyme hypothesis. What it means actually is one gene is responsible for the production of one enzyme. Although this hypothesis does not hold true in the present light of knowledge, because now we know that enzyme is not only made up of only one polypeptide, while the enzymes are made up of more than one polypeptide. Beadle and Tetum, they worked on an organism Neurospora cressa. Neurospora cressa was irradiated with X-rays. X-rays are the mutagens which can bring about change in the genetic makeup of an organism. So, the wild-type spores of Neurospora, they could grow on a minimal media. Now, what a medium is? Medium is basically the food for growing the bacteria. Then, the wild-type spores could grow on the minimal media, but the X-ray irradiated spores, some of them could not grow on the minimal media. They require arginine. Arginine is an amino acid. They required that amino acid arginine for their growth, and these mutants were created on exposure to X-rays. So, Beadle and Tetum, they proposed that some enzyme during the irradiation of X-rays, some gene has been mutated, and the Neurospora cressa mutated spores were not able to synthesize arginine. So, the arginine is to be provided in the medium for its growth. And they proposed this one gene, one enzyme hypothesis. The first experiment to prove that DNA is the genetic material was given by Griffith. He was working on an organism, Streptococcus pneumoniae. Streptococcus pneumoniae is a bacterium and it causes pneumonia. Griffith injected different strains of the Streptococcus pneumoniae into the mouse. The different strains were, as you can see in the slide, the red strains are the virulent strains and they are known as smooth strains. They are smooth because they are covered with a capsule, polysaccharide capsule. And the blue strains that we can see in a slide are the rough strain of Streptococcus pneumoniae. When he injected the smooth strains of Streptococcus pneumoniae into the mouse, it resulted in a disease and ultimately the mouse dies. When the mouse was injected with the rough strains of Streptococcus pneumoniae, the mouse did not catch the disease and the mouse lives. Now, in the third set of experiment, he injected heat-killed smooth strain of Streptococcus pneumoniae into the mouse. The mouse lives. It means once the bacterium has been killed by heat, it is not enough to cause a disease in an organism. Then he, in fourth set of experiment, he injected a mouse with heat-killed smooth and living rough strain of the bacteria. As we can see in the slide, the yellow ones are the heat-killed smooth strain and blue are the living rough strain of Streptococcus pneumoniae. When mice was injected with both of these, the mouse dies. The actual expectation of this result was, because we have injected them with the smooth heat-killed bacteria, which will not cause the disease, and the rough strain also does not cause the disease, but still the mouse died. To find out what is the reason of the death of an organism, he isolated the bacteria from the dead mouse and he found that all the bacteria were of smooth type and they were living. What has resulted in the transformation of the rough bacterium into the smooth ones? To find out, to explain this, he suggested that there was some transforming principle that was present in the heat-killed smooth bacteria, which has resulted in the transformation of rough bacterium into the smooth ones. He could not explain what that transforming principle was. Then scientists Avery, MacLeod and McCarty, they purified the chemical composition of heat-killed Streptococcus pneumoniae. As we know that all organisms are basically made up of fats, proteins, carbohydrates, minerals, vitamins. So they extracted these components from the heat-killed Streptococcus pneumoniae, that was the smooth strain. As we can see in the topmost tube, that there is a solution in which lipids and the sugar has been removed and the solution contains proteins, DNA and RNA. In the first tube, we can see that the enzyme RNAs has been added to remove the RNA. RNAs is an enzyme which digests the RNA. So now in this solution, we have only DNA and the proteins. When this solution was put into a flask containing the rough bacteria, as you can see in the flask, the rough strain was added. There was a transformation of rough strain into the smooth strain after some time. In the second set, he added an enzyme proteinase to digest proteins. And now in this tube, only the DNA and the RNA is present. And when this solution was added into a medium containing the rough strain, this rough strain transformed into the smooth strain. As we can see in the flask, the rough strain has been transformed into a smooth strain. In the third set, he added enzyme DNAs, which will digest the DNA, and the tube contains only proteins and the RNA. When this solution was added into the flask containing the rough bacteria, the rough bacteria did not change to the smooth type. They remain only rough strain. He could find only the rough strain in that bacteria. So this proves beyond doubt that DNA is the genetic material. Another scientist, Hershey and Chase, they worked on a bacteriophage to prove beyond doubt that DNA is the genetic material. Bacteriophage, what is a bacteriophage? Bacteriophage is a virus that infects the bacteria. And this T2 bacteriophage infects E. coli, as in we have certain human viruses also, like HIV is a virus, and in plants, tobacco mosaic virus. Same way, the virus which infects bacteria are the bacteriophages. Bacteriophage has a very simple structure. It has a protein coat and a DNA structure which is present inside the protein coat. What Hershey did, he grew those bacteriophage on a medium containing radioactive sulfur, and in another set, he grew those bacteriophage in a medium containing radioactive phosphorus. Now, why he used radioactive sulfur and radioactive phosphorus? The reason being, the proteins are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, but some of the amino acids like methionine, they contain sulfur. Sulfur is not found in the DNA, but we do find this sulfur element in some proteins. And in another set, he grew those bacteriophage on a medium containing radioactive phosphorus, because phosphorus we do not find in proteins. Phosphorus is a component of a DNA, which we'll study later on. When the phage that was grown on a radioactive sulfur and phosphorus, they were used to infect the bacterium. The first step is the infection, as you can see in the slide. When they were used to infect the bacterium, the genetics material was supposed to move into the cell. Okay, in the first slide, we can see that the protein coat is attached to the surface of the bacterium. That was the infection stage. That bacteria and the phage, they were incubated together. Now, once we know that the infection has taken place, the solution was blended. The blending is done in the same way as we do in our houses. We use the blenders. In laboratory, the tubes are small and the smaller blenders with very high speed are used. Now, what is the reason that we have used this blending is to separate out the phage particles from the bacterium particles. Once the phage and the bacterium has been separated out in the solution, now we need a pure solution of the bacteria so that we can find out whether the bacterium contains the radioactive sulfur or the phosphorus. So, third step after blending was the centrifugation. When we centrifuge that solution, based on the sedimentation coefficient of the bacterium and the phage, they will separate out at the different places in a tube. When the bacterium was purified and analyzed for the presence of radioactive sulfur and phosphorus, it was found that bacterium contained the radioactive phosphorus. So, this proved that DNA is the genetic material, because phosphorus is a component of DNA only. You know that nature selects from variability, and eukaryotic organisms, they have meiosis, then sexual reproduction as the means of generating the variability. How do these prokaryotic organisms, they generate the variability and help in the movement of genes from one strain to another? There are different ways. The three different ways are conjugation, transformation, and transduction. This slide explains how conjugation takes place in a bacteria. You can see the red one is the main genome and the blue is a plasmid. Plasmid is an extra chromosomal element which is present in some bacteria. The bacteria containing the plasmid are known as the F plus plasmid. And adjacent to that, we can see there is another bacterium which contains only the main genome, but no extra chromosomal element or plasmid is present. In the F plus bacteria, in the first set, we can see a stick type of thing is attached to the bacteria. That is a pili. This pili is formed between F plus and F negative bacteria. F negative is the one which is not containing the plasmid. Once the pili is formed, the genetic material is transferred from F plus to F minus bacterium, that is the recipient, from the donor to the recipient bacterium. We know that DNA, we'll study later on also, that DNA is a double helical structure. Same way, plasmid is also a double helical. So, one template of that plasmid will remain in the donor and the another is passed on to the recipient. And later they will make their own copy. Now, as in the fourth set, you can see that both the bacterium are now carrying the plasmid and has a capability to form the pili. This is known as conjugation, that plasmid has been transferred from a bacterium which was F plus and contains the plasmid to a bacterium which lacks the plasmid. The another method, that is the transformation. Transformation is the same that Griffith studied. What happened in that case was the nascent DNA which was present around the rough strain, that was taken up by those bacteria. Some of the DNA of the smooth type was moving around in that medium and it was absorbed by the rough strain. And when this DNA on absorption into the bacterium gets integrated into the main genome of the bacterium and start expressing itself and then transform that into a smooth type. So that is an example of transformation. That is how transformation occurs in bacteria. Now, third method is the transduction, that I can explain through the Hershey and Chase experiment. When the bacteriophage infects the bacteria, we know that viruses, they have a capability of using the host machinery to make their own copies. They get integrated into the host machinery. The virus gets integrated into the main genome of the bacteria. It will make its own copies. And while making its own copies, some of the genome part, some part of the genome gets attached to the virus genome. And when this virus breaks the bacterial cell and infects the another bacterium, that results into the transduction. When it infects the other bacterium, that genome from the first bacterium gets transferred to the next bacteria. So this is known as transduction. Now, we know that DNA is the genetic material. What is the structure of DNA? DNA is a double helical structure. As you can see in this slide, that these are the two helices which are coiled around each other. You must have seen a rope. The way the rope, two strings of ropes are coiled around each other, and even if you open it, they again coil back. Same case, the two strands of DNA are coiled around each other, and these are the two polynucleotide chains. Now, what this DNA is made up of? DNA is made up of three compounds: sugar, bases, and the phosphate. Now, sugar is a ribose sugar. Ribose is a pentose sugar. Pentose means it's a 5-carbon sugar, as you can see in the first diagram. The first carbon is on the right-hand side of the oxygen. Then second carbon in the ring, and third is to the third carbon, the hydroxyl is attached. Then the fourth carbon and the third hydroxyl group that is there on the ring, that is the place where the fifth carbon is attached. Okay, so that is a pentose sugar which is made up of 5 carbons. Then we have the bases. There are 2 categories of bases. They are purines and pyrimidines, as you can see in the slide. The double ring structures are the purines. Purines are guanine and adenine, and pyrimidines are thymine and cytosine. Thymine and cytosine are a single ring structure. When sugar is attached to a base, it becomes a nucleoside. And when sugar is attached to base and then to the phosphate, it becomes a nucleotide. This is the structure of the DNA. Then you can see there is another ribose sugar that I have drawn over here. That is a 5-carbon sugar again. This explains the structure of a RNA now. The second set, which is beneath the deoxyribose, we have a ribose sugar. It is again a 5-carbon sugar. The difference between RNA and DNA is, in RNA, all three bases, out of those four bases, the three bases, that is adenine, guanine and cytosine, are the same. But instead of thymine, in case of RNA, the uracil is present. Now, in this slide, you can see how the nucleotides are attached. The model of DNA was given by Watson and Crick in 1953, and they were awarded the Nobel Prize for their work on the structure of DNA. You can see these sugars and phosphate, they form the backbone of the DNA, and the nitrogenous bases are present in the center. Now, what are the characteristics of this DNA? The DNA molecule consists of two polynucleotide chains that are spirally twisted around each other and are coiled around a common axis. The two strands are antiparallel. Antiparallel, by antiparallel we means, as you can see, that one strand is on the top side, it's from 5 prime to 3 prime, and the other polynucleotide chain is, the lower side has a 5 prime end and the upper side has a 3 prime end. So they are antiparallel. Sugar and phosphate, they form the backbone and they are present on the outside, while core of the helix contains the purines and pyrimidine bases. Adenine always pairs with thymine through two hydrogen bonds, and guanine always pairs with cytosine through three hydrogen bonds. The base composition of the DNA obeys the Sharkov's rule. Sharkov's rule is, the number of adenine present in a DNA is equal to the number of thymine, and the number of total number of cytosine present in a DNA is equal to the number of guanine. The diameter of DNA is 20 nanometers. That is, the distance between two phosphates is 20 nanometers. And in one coil of DNA, over here, in one coil of DNA, the 10 base pairs can be adjusted, and the distance between the two base pairs is 0.34 nanometers. And in one coil, total 10 number of base pairs can be adjusted. So, diameter of DNA is 20 nanometer, adjacent bases are separated by 0.34 nanometers, and the length of the complete turn of helix is 3.4 nanometers. So, there are 10 base pairs per turn. Now, DNA, if we take the DNA of a human beings, it comes out to be 2.2 meters. So, how come this such a big size of DNA is packed into a nucleus? That is through certain molecules, the proteins that are the histones, positive proteins. Around these positive proteins, the DNA is coiled. When around these positive proteins, they form an octamer. 8 such proteins, they form an octamer. This is known as a histone octamer that you can see in the slide. And around this, the DNA is coiled. As you can see in the nucleosome, where I have written the nucleosome. So, it forms a beaded structure. And the further coiling ultimately leads to the formation of metaphase chromosome, which we can see even under the light microscope. While the DNA molecule, which is just 2 nanometer, we cannot see under the light microscope. So, it gets condensed when it gets coiled and supercoiled. Now, with this, we'll come to the last slide of this session, that is the difference between the DNA and the RNA. DNA is a double helical structure, while the RNA is a single helical. DNA contains deoxyribose sugar and RNA contains the ribose sugar. DNA has pyrimidine base complementary to adenine is thymine, and pyrimidine base complementary to adenine is uracil in case of RNA. DNA has only one function, that is to bear the hereditary information, while RNA performs many functions in the protein synthesis, and there are different types of RNAs available: messenger RNA, transfer RNA, and the ribosomal RNA. Besides that, RNA also acts as a genetic material in case of retroviruses. DNA can duplicate on its own, but RNA can be synthesized using a DNA template. So I hope that now you know what is the structure which is responsible for the inheritance of characters, that is the DNA, and what is the structure of DNA. So in the next part, we'll take up how does this DNA replicates and how does the gene expresses itself into the form of proteins. I hope the session was fruitful for you people, and it will help you in understanding the structure of DNA. And thank you. So see you next time.